vulture, probably about 500 meters, 600 meters, or 1800 feet or 2000 feet or so from the carcass. But they probably, well, might not be able to see the buffalo from there, but certainly can see the other vultures. And as soon as they start to descend, it will be an indicator that the lions have moved off, and this vulture will then go in there as well. So they're very patient, and they use their unbelievable eyesight to stay safe and far away from any potential danger. It's difficult to look at a vulture and think, beautiful bird, I must confess. One does look at them and feel a deep sense of appreciation. But beauty, not so much. Virginia, you're in Kentucky and you're wondering about whether or not these vultures will be chased by the lions if they come down too soon. Yes, they will definitely. If the vultures go anywhere near that carcass while the lions are still there, they'll be chased away, and if they don't move quickly, they'll be killed. So they're very careful of the lions. The hooded vultures, we saw them on the ground yesterday, almost in between the lions, but mainly because they were eating the lion dung. They weren't going anywhere near, and I nearly retched as I said that. They weren't going anywhere near the buffalo carcass. Those vultures there, the white back, they want meat. They want the rotting carcass. They're not interested in eating lion dung. That is beneath them. And so they will wait for the lions to go away completely. Now, I don't know if you've noticed, but the sky has turned from perfectly gorgeous winter blue to slightly ominous gray. And I believe there was a front coming in today. Well, there it is. It has arrived. We had one day off winter, and we're back into it. But we're going to find now, yes, they're going to be cold snaps. We're going to find the temperature increasing slowly over the next month, quite substantially, but for when there are fronts coming through. And September is often one of our hottest months, interestingly, before the rains start. I'm not particularly looking forward to that, I have to tell you, after the summer of last year. Right, now I wanted to show you this. Take my leggy blankie off. Now, many of you have seen these, of course, and the question that was asked of me yesterday by Jean Dre while we were driving around was whether or not these baboons' tails, which is what these plants are, many of you will have seen them before, whether or not they will flower now. You've lost sound.
Yeah, that's back now.
How's that? You can still hear me, can you? How's that?
Yep.
Yes? Whether or not they would flower at this time of the year, and I said I thought they might, given their water, but they've sprouted just as a result of the 20 millimeters of rain we had here, just under an inch, somewhere between half an inch and an inch, depending on where you are on the reserve, and they've sprouted almost immediately, and they're now starting to go yellow again. So just almost as quickly as they've come up, they're going to go down again, so maybe they won't flower. But what I wanted to show you, if I can just break off a piece here. We were talking about xerophytic plants yesterday, so succulents, or plants that can cope with dry desert conditions. And this is not a true succulent. And I always thought it was until I broke it open. But if you look at the end of it there, there are a whole lot of thin tubes. It's made up of a great sort of matrix of thin tubes. Now, these sort of thin tubes have what we got, or will create an effect called capillary action. And capillary action is a kind of spontaneous vacuum. So if you put a thin enough tube into liquid, the liquid will, because of the internal pressure within the liquid, will push up the tube. And that's what this is made of. It's basically made of lots and lots of capillary tubes, which makes it massively efficient at absorbing water when there is some in the surface, and so it sprouts very quickly. But it also means that as soon as the water leaves the surface of the soil, it gets sucked out, and so it goes completely dormant. It's really quite an interesting, well, I think fascinating plant, and that is the baboon's tail, Xerophyta retinervis. You like Xerophyta retinervis, Vim?
Yes, it sounds like a combat game character.
It sounds like a combat game character. Yes, maybe you should have that as your Dota character, Xerophyta retinervis. my blankie back on. It's so cold. Kirsten, you're going to have to go with that name again. Ah, Fuzzman Sparkles, of course. That also is an excellent name for a character, don't you think, Liam? Fuzzman Sparkles and Zero Fighter Ready Nervous. Fuzzman Sparkles, you want to know if any animals eat the baboon's tail? Fuzzman Sparkles, I'm going to call you FMS from now on. FMS, I don't know if any animals eat them. I don't think they do greatly. The leaves, yes, I've certainly seen some grazers eating the leaves. But this thing, I think, is largely nutrient-free. It's basically just a conduit for water to get into the leaves. No. Doesn't taste very good at all. Fuzzman Sparkles. Justin, you want to know what my favorite bush or tree to eat in the bushes? Well, I mean, the marula fruit is definitely the favorite. But otherwise, there's not a great deal out here other than fruits on the bushes, which are, you know, you get white berry bushes, which are nice. The gory bushes make quite nice fruit. The sour plums make delicious fruit. But otherwise, if you're a vegetarian living out here, I think you'd really struggle to survive, to be honest. And there's not much to eat in the way of sort of salad-y type things, but for that of the leaves of Sisyphus mucronata, they taste pretty good. But the rest out here, no, really not great for salad or vegetarian eating. Tubers, you get some that you can eat, very bitter, and a number of very toxic lily tubers. You really got to be very careful about what you eat there. Herbert, of course, and we'll get back out and bushwalk fairly soon. Herbert is brilliant with that sort of stuff. He could probably survive out here eating just vegetation. I think I'd get very thin and die quite quickly. Just driving past a whole field here of baboons' tails and seeing if I can spot a flower. And I know Brent was talking about flowers earlier, and I said to Viam, rather sarcastically, I said he's got much more chance of finding Karula and the cubs than he does of a wild flower at this time of the year. And I may be forced to eat my words if I can find the baboon's tail flower. But that's quite interesting. They haven't produced any there. See that? Despite all of the greenery here. Righty. On we go. We're going to continue down towards the south, I think, and maybe try and give Brent a bit of a hand trying to find Karula's tracks. Very hard, crusted ground at the moment. While we do that, let's go back across to the inimitable fellow himself and see what he's managed to find.
Well, we haven't managed to find too much, and as you can see, we're having a bit of a quiet sunrise safari. Luckily, James was with those incredible Nkuhumas, but we've been working in grid-like pattern. We checked up to Sydney's Dam, we've checked down Triple M, we've checked the whole of Gari Main, we've checked Cheetah Cutline. So now I'm doing Drakensberg, and we're basically just going to zigzag our way through Djuma, hoping to find a track. Oh, sorry, I think Abel's calling me. So we worked it out on drive the other afternoon, and since I've been at Safari Live, which is about a year and 6 months now, I have seen 20 different individual leopards, and that's not all the ones you guys might have enjoyed on the drives, because I know, well, with Jamie you would have seen Shiluva 2005 model, so that's 21, and then also Scott saw Bahuti, that's 22. And I think 22 leopards is about all the leopards we've seen in the last year and a half or so. So that's incredible for the size of area we operate in, the fact that we've seen 22 different individual leopards. Hi, ex-ranger. Ex-ranger is wondering about the leopard scat collection program and the paternity tests and when there's going to be information. So with all of these major scientific projects, before any of that information is available to public or to anyone, it has to go through peer review. It's going to be years before that data is available. Hopefully a year rather than years, but one must also realize that that Panthera has got a lot of other projects going on, and even that scat collection is more and to identify the different genetics of leopards is the paternity in the Sabi Sands is a very low low priority study in that greater study. So the main reason for collecting the scat and getting the genetic markers from the scat is for conservation reasons. So there's still quite a legal trade in leopard skins for different reasons all over Africa. So what they're doing is collecting genetics from as many different leopards from as many different parts of Africa as possible to try establish when an illegal skin is found or confiscated. They can test it against that database to find out where exactly did that skin originate from, which will also help figuring out which leopard populations are under the most threat. So from so far, the first initial set of data from the conservation point of view has shown that the two leopard populations that are under the most threat in southern and east Africa is northern Mozambique, southern Tanzania. That is where most of the illegally obtained skins are coming from. So even though in those illegal skins, I think there were four or five skins that were genetically traced back to Sabi Sands leopards. So that type of information is really important for an organization like Panthera to establish future plans for leopard conservation, not only in the very limited areas like the Sabi Sands or Greater Kruger, but to get a plan for the whole of Africa. I hope that helps explain a little bit better. So while we zoot off to go help Herbie try to find those leopards, let's go see where James is and what he's up to.
James is not too far from where Brent is. As far as I understand it, Herbert has got some leopard tracks over there, around there. So we're just going to lurk around this area. Of course, if we find Karula, Brent will be deeply upset with us. Well, he'll probably be quite happy with us. He'll be gracious about it. I just wanted to quickly stop at this tree here. It is a knobthorn that has been destroyed by the elephants, you can see, and continues to grow miraculously. Very few knobthorns actually do survive the attentions of elephants. This one wasn't de-rooted or debarked, so it has managed to survive, but very clearly going to be favoured forage as we go towards the business end of the dry season. The birds have shut up, but for one or two doves, and that's because I think the sun has disappeared behind these clouds. Then why is this car doing that when I started? It's going vroo,
vroo.
Messed up
idle control.
Yeah. VM says it has a messed up idle control. I think I probably could have told him that. I just don't know what that means. Right, can you see me? You want to know where the elephants have gone. Can you see me? I have no idea where the elephants have gone. I'd love to know myself. I came up with a theory all on my own the other day as to why it is sometimes we have elephants here and then they disappear. So you go around every tree, shake a bush, and an elephant falls out of it. And then that happens for a week or two, and then they're gone for a week or two, and then they come back again. I have a theory, and it's totally untested, so it might be utter nonsense, but we know that trees talk to each other. We know that they're able to communicate through pheromones, possibly also through fungal mycelia in the ground that was taught to us by our old pal Sam Chevalier. And I suspect that because elephants have such a profound effect on the vegetation of an area, that eventually an entire area, rather than one tree becoming distasteful by, you know, producing tannins because it's being preyed on. So just as a bit of background, that's what will happen. If something like an impala goes to eat on a tree, it will, depends on the species of tree, but many trees will then increase the tannin production. The impala will then have to move away to another tree or to a few trees along, because it becomes distasteful and becomes quite toxic. Now, if you have a whole herd of elephants blasting through an area like this, I think it's quite likely that every tree in the area starts to communicate with these pheromones, and because they eat so many different species of trees, even if they're not talking inter-specifically, they're talking intra-specifically, so within each species of tree, and I think you'll find an entire area will suddenly become distasteful to the elephants. They'll move away, they'll have to go and eat somewhere else. And then when that kind of effect is reduced, because it's expensive for a tree to produce tannins and other toxins, when those tannins have leaked out and stopped being produced, then the elephants will come back. That's my guess. I don't think it's too bad a theory. Do you, VM? No, you weren't listening. So VM doesn't know if my theory was good or bad. Right, I'm going to drive you through a knobthorn tree. I did it 10 minutes ago, I'm going to do it again. You're in big trouble now. My ego is much too large for you to be ignoring what I have to say. And Stephen in the UK, you want to know why we haven't seen any rhinos. Stephen, it's because we don't show rhinos. There is a school of thought that says, you know, if we show rhinos on Wild Earth and people are really astute and perhaps know where we are, there's a possibility that the scourge of poaching let's pretend there was a poacher watching, that they could then find the rhino. It's possible. Any effect that we could have negatively on the rhino poaching situation in this area, we don't want to, and that's why we just don't show rhino. We do see them every so often, but we don't show them on the camera, and we'll move the camera away. So sometimes we'll be driving along like this, there'll be rhino over there, and we'll just keep talking like this, and we just ignore them and carry on going. It's a very sad situation, but unfortunately I think it is probably the right call for now. Whether or not we'd have an effect on poaching, we don't know. If there's the slightest possibility that we could, then absolutely it's the best idea just simply not to show rhino. But that, Stephen, is why we don't see them. They do occur here, and it's a very sad thing that we can't show you the joys of little white rhino calves and their magnificent mothers and the really impressive white rhino bulls that we do get in this area. I can hear a woodpecker calling up ahead. I just want to see if we can't see it, because this camera that we have has that super zoom. There it is. It's right on the top of that tree there, Vimpy. You see it there? The very pinnacle of the tree is a cardinal woodpecker. There we are. Brilliant. Just surveying its domain. You're right at the end of the lens there.
Yes, all the way.
So the slight shake you can see in the picture there, everyone, is because we're right at the end of the lens, which means that every time VM's heart beats, that's really what's happening. There's just a slight jolt. What happens if you let go completely? No, the bird flies away. I see. Hi Gail, nice one from you, especially after this morning. You say the bird calls sound louder and more stridulant the closer to spring we get, and certainly this morning was very loud, and you say it's breeding time. No, it's nowhere near breeding time yet. I think it's a function of the sun we had this morning and the bit of rain that we had the other day. It probably would have brought out a few insects and probably made some of the male birds a bit more territorial. yes, certainly the changing day length is going to move us towards the breeding season, but we're not at breeding season for the birds yet, no. Nowhere near enough insects, nowhere near enough in the way of seeds and flowers and that sort of thing for them to eat, or fruits. Here's a waterbuck. And just as I say that, everyone, what I do want you to do is keep an eye out, and an impala. Our cup runneth over, Vian. That is a particularly dun-coloured waterbuck, isn't it? It's not very grey. Let me just move a little bit forward. 1st of August, it's time to start looking for the very first Wahlberg's eagle. They are the first to come back. And let's see if they don't come back fairly soon. You know, that chap really doesn't want to be on camera. Or that lady. There we have the impala. And he is obviously relieving himself. That is just what happens. As soon as I look at an animal, it decides to void its bowels. Impala all looking in pretty good nick, despite the seeming paucity of good things to eat, and very, very efficient users of water, most of the African antelope out here. And you can see that from the little pellets of dung. Those little pellets of dung are basically, they're not dry completely, but they are very dry. And the impala and most of the antelope out here, and especially the gazelle, something like a springbok, which you don't find here, but in the drier areas, they've got exceptionally efficient kidneys that suck out all the water, and so their dung comes out almost dry. Unlike the buffalo, of course, which is very poor with water conservation and has to drink a huge amount. Now, Brent is now on some leopard tracks. He is off the vehicle, so with any luck, we will have a leopard fairly soon. But you know what these leopards are like. Particularly good at hiding from us. So we'll now drive off down a road called Leadwood Road, down towards the valley of the Mulwati, and we'll see if we get lucky. Hello, Aaron in New Zealand. Lovely to hear from you again. And you say you're hoping for the Anderson male leopard. That would be a great birthday present for you. Well, happy birthday, Aaron. But the Anderson male, highly unlikely to be found where we are now. We're now on the very eastern fringes of Djuma, and the Anderson male only stretches to the sort of western fringes of Arathusa, and sometimes up to the Arathusa Lodge, which is kind of in the middle of Arathusa, that's off to the west of us. So to find him here would be very unusual indeed. But we'll do our best, Aaron. If we find giant male leopard tracks, most likely him, and we'll get on them as soon as we can. Oof, it's really taking on a late season colour. Let's have a look over this viewpoint here, beyond this very picturesque dead knob thorn tree. Now, if you look straight ahead of us there, you can see that the vegetation has taken on that kind of greyish, browny, coppery, goldy colour. And that's completely normal for this time of the year, but it is different from when I left here. When I left here, it was copper and gold, because all of the cambretum leaves had turned that colour, and they were all starting to fall off now. And now you can see that they are... Hang on, I'm just going to talk to Herbie. Now you can see that all the leaves have fallen. Herbie, Brent's on foot, I think. Go ahead. Okay, Kapiya, I can't get hold of him, but we will tell him that if we can. Herbert has found a drag mark. He's not far from here at all. And so he and Brent will hopefully be lucky. Herbie, where's that drag mark going?
It's Yeah, dude, I can book a brand. I'll spoke to him.
Okay, copy. I'm on Leadwood now. I'll drive this road slowly. So, here is where Herbert says, he said north of Leadwood. You heard him there. So, he reckons somewhere in here. I think Herbert actually might have found them. We'll see now. Brent will let you know. He's not far from here. Be very exciting indeed. Of course, I will be very jealous not to see Karula's little babies. Maybe this afternoon. It sounds pretty good, I must say. So Brent's just over here. Justin, you say, which drive do I prefer, the sunset or sunrise safari? Justin, it really depends on what we see. It depends on the weather. It depends on how I'm feeling. Yeah, I really can't say which one I prefer more. I love both those times of the day, the crepuscular times of the day, just as the sun set and just before it comes up. I think, interestingly enough, for driving around and absorbing the peace of the wilderness, I find the evening probably slightly more pleasurable. And in the morning, it's just that much more exciting because you have this sort of feeling of expectation. So it just depends on how I'm feeling, whether I want excitement or I want some peace. Yeah, it really has changed quite substantially in the last little while. The vegetation, I mean, and the colors. And just to give you an idea, there is a substantial drainage line running down through this sort of section of the reserve. And I think it's probably in there that Herbert and Brent are frantically scrabbling about for Karula and her cubs. Ginny, you want to know if the animals will eat the dead leaves. We did an experiment, excuse me, we did an experiment before I went on leave a few times where we picked some dead leaves and we picked them off the ground and we tried them versus green leaves. They really taste like nothing at all. So no, I haven't seen animals eating dead leaves. I've no doubt that they do every so often for roughage, but I don't think they're very good forage at all. I think you'll find the nutrients have basically dried out of them. So unless animals were fairly desperate, I don't think they'd be eating the dead leaves, because there certainly are plenty of them around. And, you know, you'd expect to find them eating dead leaves much more often. There's some arrow-marked babblers in here, but I think they're probably... I think the bush is too thick there. I don't think we're going to get a good view of them. And I'm scanning the skies for the first Wahlberg's eagle. I think we had the first one last year, around about the 8th of August. But any time from now. And yellow-billed kites, also another migratory bird we can hope to see fairly soon. Yes, I don't see any leopards or there or cubs here. Thank you, Sharon in Ohio. You say you're very happy to have me back. I was almost honored when I heard that, and then you said you were quite worried because none of the animals were going to the toilet in my absence. Well, Sharon, I'm most glad that I have now relieved what must have been a very trying time for them, not being able to relieve themselves in my absence. I'm so pleased, Sharon, that I've managed to have some good conservation effect. There's another field of baboon's tails here, and I'm just scanning them to see if there isn't a flower. But I don't see even one. I don't even see a bud. Now if we switch off here, I can hear Brent Lear Smith driving through the bushes. It sounds like 300 or 400 elephants. So I'm sure they've got something, which is very exciting. I suppose he could have just gone in from this side. He's coming from the other side, everyone, and he's only about, I don't know, 40 meters from where we are now. There. Have you got Herbert too? Well, here, Herbert will give us an update. Herberto! Minjani kwalan? Ukumetingwe? Tikui? He did find them. Tila? Tilikswan?
Yeah. Langako Brent.
Okay. So he says Brent is on his way there to the leopards. Tijil?
Okay. Fresh blood.
Okay. Good.
Fresh nyama.
Fresh food? And so that's brilliant. We should have a sighting for a few hours to come. As soon as Brent's in there, we'll cross over to him. In fact, let's head straight across to Brent right now.
So we've managed to find the remains of a kill, but I can't see any leopards. There's a bit of meat left there. Not much though, remains of an impala. So we're right in a little river system. Now the leopards can't be too far off if there's still meat. Now we've got male tracks, we've got Karula and cub tracks. So trying to figure out who this kill belongs to, or was it stolen by a male? We don't know. So we're going to check around in this little river system for a bit more. There must be a leopard really close to us somewhere. Now, Xongile spotted that carcass. Well done, Xongile. Okay. Now, we're just going to move out to the other side. Maybe the leopard's lying up just a little bit away from the carcass.
They're very fresh leopard tracks around, so I'm sure they are around. Like I said, it is not easy in there. And so I expect they'll probably come back. And as we've said many times, if you do see something like a leopard on foot, 9 times out of 10 they'll move away. And often, of course, they will see you before you see them. And so it's quite possible that the leopards would have just moved away a little bit from Herbert, and then they'll come back to feed now. So let's just drive slowly through here. Brent will look around in the block there, and then we'll go down up towards the Mulwati drainage line. And maybe we'll find something else as well. I must say there hasn't been a great plethora of plains game lurking around here. And I find this particular part of the reserve is often quite quiet for that when we're at this time of the year. And that's because there's just not a great deal to eat. Anyway, let's hope Brent finds the leopards. We'll go in search of perhaps an elephant or two. We were asked earlier about plants to eat, and as I said, and I mean most of you will know this, but I just said that there's really only one salad-y type of plant to eat, and the best one is this. Oh dear, my microphone is going to pull out of my hat. Hang on. There we go. It's the Sisyphus tree. And you're not a great fan, are you? Really a very acceptable salad substitute. Very few others though. All of them tend to have a very bitter taste, and that's because they defend themselves from being eaten by being bitter. And this one especially, this is the gwari bush. This is a Natal gwari. You'll find that they don't get eaten at all because they taste so foul. They've got hairs on the leaves, which of course makes them, well, it's a bit like licking a peach. What are those yellow peaches called? They have a special name. VM's looking very confused, as I am. Let's see if Kirsten can give me the name. But if you lick one of those peaches, they don't taste so good. And it's the same with these Natal Gwaris. Yeah. Yeah, they really are so bitter. And that's why the animals, many of the cats, will mark their territory on these Gwari bushes. No, not an apricot, Kirsten. It's a kind of a peach. An apricot. No, it's not an apricot. No, it's not a nectarine, it's a peach. But it's got, it's a something peach, it's a something peach. The yellow ones with the hair on them. No. Oh, come on, somebody help me here, I'm gonna go mad. Nectarine. It's a kind of cultivar of peach. Anyway, I'm sure you all know what I mean. Maybe you don't. Ooh. Male leopard tracks here. He is not very fresh. In fact, fairly old. Not quite big enough for Anderson, I'm afraid, Aaron. And not here recently. I'll have to find out about those peaches when we get back. There's a lilac-breasted roller. Hello. Couldn't you make a slightly more pretty sound? Thank you very much. Someone called Brian Joubert, we don't know if it's our Brian Joubert, on YouTube, says a cling peach. That's exactly what it is. Thank you very much. I do hope it is our Brian Joubert. I'd be most impressed if he's watching and he managed to pick that up. Thank you, Brian. Cling peach. That's exactly correct. Beautiful bird. I'm just going to talk to Brent. He's hailing me. Go ahead. I'll let you hear him.
On Leadwood Road.
I am still on Leadwood Road.
Check if you have my vehicle with you. If you wouldn't mind checking, if possible, if there's a way in to the southern side of the drainage system. I cannot cross it from where I am. I think if they did see Herbie, they would have moved to the south.
Okay, copy. Do you want me to go in there and have a look?
Hey, Firm, I'm going to stand by and test the carcass if anything pops up here.
So you've heard that strategy. I do know of a little road in here that goes down towards where Brent was, so we'll go and have a look there. Copy, Brent, we'll go and have a look there. It is our Brian. That's marvellous stuff. Thank you. Brian's coming back, I think, tomorrow, everybody. So that'll be nice to have him back. And VM says, Brian, could you bring his headphones back, please, that he left there? He'd very much like that. If you could bring some cling peaches with you, Brian, that would be great too, but I think we'll probably only find them in summertime. Female leopard tracks? Yes, there is a female leopard track, and that looks like quite a fresh one. Let me get out and show you. Can you see it with the camera?
Not anymore. The door's blown
out. But you can see it if I shut the door. Here is a female leopard track. There.
Yeah, it's out of range.
That is so deeply irksome. I can't move the car so that you can see it, everybody. Anyway, there's a female leopard track going down the road there. I'm just not sure how fresh that is. It's definitely fresher than the male. So let's just do a little turn. What I'm going to do, in fact, I'm going to go back up this way and I'm going to tell Herbert that there were female tracks here. Well spotted, VM. Brilliant tracking. Obviously, as always. Herbert, do you copy? Now, Brent is over there. We're going to go into the block here, towards where the carcass was, and see if we don't get lucky. I'm just going to quickly try and tell Herbert. Herbert, do you copy? Alright, while I try and sort out what's going out here, let's go across to Brent and get an update from him.
So what I've done, I'm pulling things. Is it still in? No, it's not. Oh dear. Me and cables are just not a good combination. There we go, John Ray, look at the drainage. So what we've done is we're right next to where the carcass is, but if that leopard or leopards saw Herbie on foot, sometimes they'll just move off slightly. So we're sitting where we've got a bit of a better view from where we are. We can see a bit further, but as you can see, we're not getting a vehicle through that area. So what I've asked James to do is come in from the other side, because they might have just crossed the drainage, but I don't want to go too far away from the carcass. So I just want to sit here and listen. The other thing is, this could be Djuma. So there are male leopard tracks in the area, and if it is Djuma, unfortunately, as soon as he heard us driving in, he's gone. There's not much meat left there, and it's possible he might even abandon the carcass. But we do have Karula and cub tracks in this area as well. So lots of question marks, no answers, but we do have meat, and meat is a good place to start when looking for leopards. So we're just sitting carefully. I'm listening for any little sign, probably not a noise by the leopards. What I'm really listening for is a little alarm call by some birds that spot the leopard close by. But we're very, very confident that there is a leopard somewhere within 100 meters of us, whether it's a shy leopard that's just watching us through the trees, or whether it's Queen Karula and the cubs, and possibly even Tingana. He might have snuck across without us seeing the tracks. Although I doubt that, unless he crossed into Torchwood. Well, so many unanswered questions, but exciting times, because we know there's a leopard here somewhere. There's enough meat, I think, to warrant the leopard coming back. And James Richard said he's always up for leopards, so holding thumbs right now. I thought I had, where's my binoculars? So just at the top of the drainage where the sharp corner is above there, I thought I saw a bit of movement. It could have been a bird, but I don't see anything now. Now, of course, leopards are incredibly well camouflaged. And if they're lying, they could be lying mere meters from us, watching us. I'm just doing a little loop. We'll come back through here. I just want to show you something absolutely fascinating. And it's not often you get to see things like this, so let's go have a look. If I can sneak my way between the rocks. Is that bigger rock than I thought it was? Oh, it's a large tree and a rock, and it was a bigger rock than I thought it was. There we go, and we'll sneak through here. So I want to show you the reason we brought the vehicle in here, and it is incredible. It's not something we get to see too often. The spot where the kill took place. I'm going to go behind the vehicle. I don't want to walk down towards the drainage in case the leopards are watching. So I'm going to go behind. So I'm going to disappear from view for a few seconds. Okay, look at this. Isn't this absolutely incredible? Now, the other reason I wanted to come look here is see if I can make out whether it's a male. And, I mean, this is... Look at this, congealed blood. So, judging on the congealing, it was yesterday, maybe late in the afternoon. And I just want to have a now careful look. You can see this is where that leopard managed to catch that impala. It looks like it happened right here. And then there's been much rolling and tumbling. And it actually expired here. And what this little bit of pile of congealed blood and dung here tells me is the leopard actually started feeding on it before dragging it into cover. And I'm looking for tracks now to tell me whether it's a male or a female, whether it's Karula. And I've got cub tracks. So there are cub tracks here as well. And I just want to double check carefully what's going on here. And so this is probably this other patch of blood up here, probably from around the throat. And see, dragged this way up against here, and the rump was here, the head was there and was being fed on. Now, just checking for these tracks very carefully. I think I see a cub track, but it's quite messy, as one would expect when tackling an animal bigger than you. But I think this is Karula and cubs. So that makes me quite happy. But the other thing is we don't know which male was here, because there are male tracks in the area as well. Did the male steal the carcass? Could it be Djuma? Did Karula mate with Djuma? Does he think it's like his babies? We hope so. Okay. I'm going to duck back around the vehicle, jump in my seat, and we're going to go check a little bit further to the northeast. We're listening. I can't hear any bird alarm calls. Now, of course, James is going to take all the credit, but he's exactly where I asked him to go check, and it seems like the leopard cubs are there.
Well, there is the leopard cub, everyone, and looks like Xongile. I can hear Brent. He's not too far from here. But I think she's killed this on her own. That is a little scrub hare. And, yeah, I can't see the others. I don't know where the male is. I don't know where the Karula is. She could be anywhere quite close by, probably in the drainage line. But that is beautiful little Xongile eating a what looks to me like a scrub hare she's just killed. So Brent is probably about, he's only about 150 feet from us. So definitely not my exceptional tracking skills that found the leopard. We did stop in this drainage line and then we heard the crunch of bone, and then we knew. I mean, I can actually see Brent. I'm just going to tell him quickly. Brent, come in. Brent, I'm just on your left-hand side there. If you look, leopard cub on her own, on Leadwood Road, just off the road. Thanks. Okay, copy. Yeah, stations, Brent and Herbert did locate an impala carcass in this area. They followed the tracks in, but we haven't found the female yet, so we'll probably just make this a one vehicle sighting at the moment, but I'm sure the mother and the other cub are around here somewhere. Cobby, can you, are you not able to get your nose to the edge of the drainage and just peep in there? I'm pretty sure everybody that, I'm pretty sure that Karula is close by. Hang on a sec, hang on if I can see her. I've got her, she's right in front of us there. Yeah, Brent, sorry, we've got the female here as well. There she is, she's just through the thickets there. Okay. You can just see there. I think we're going to hand the sighting over to Brent because he's done all the work in finding them. Brent, come out onto Leadwood and come into this position. I'll move out. I think you deserve this. That's a wonderful sighting. So did you see the female? So you can just see her there. So we're just going to wait here for Brent to get into a position where he can come in here and then we'll move out. Let me try and get one bog standard average picture while Brent comes in. And Herbie, of course, played an enormous role in finding these things. And he's sitting in the final control now, watching, very satisfied. Now, where's the little male? Whose old name I'm not allowed to say, but I desperately want to. But I won't. Isn't that fantastic? I'm sure she killed that on her own. All right, now where is the little male? He often likes to sit in trees, you know. Might not be too far from here, in a tree perhaps. And interesting, they don't, they're quite good at not fighting over food with each other, the two of them. They often don't share. Safari Hayes, you say this cub, sorry, I'm talking absolute nonsense, I forgot, these are the lighter eyes, of course. This is definitely Hosana. Sorry, it's not the female. This is the little male. You're absolutely right, Safari Hayes. Size-wise, yeah, I mean, I don't think we can tell at the moment on sight. But that's the liver being eaten there. Delicious, very nutritious, full of fat, very good. I do apologize, everyone. This is definitely the male. And you can tell that, of course, because he has the light eyes. I forgot that the female's got the dark eyes. And of course, this is also, he's got a 3-3-3 spot pattern, which I should have picked up on immediately. Now look carefully. We spoke earlier about whether or not they'll eat the stomach contents, and they won't. You can see that there. So he will eat the stomach, but he won't eat the stomach contents. All right, we're going to move out. We're going to let Brent come in here, and I'll see you the other side. Brent, you stand by there. I'll move out. Marvellous. Wasn't that nice? Thank you, Safari Hayes, for pointing out my idiocy. I'm a bit rusty after my time off. Alright, let's go across to Brent while we move out and he'll take you back in again.
So exciting, and it's awesome that we got to see where the kill actually took place. You could see the cub tracks there. And so James is just moving out. And we're moving in. We managed to find a spot to cross that steep drainage line. There we go. There's Vim and James. Hi, guys. Thanks.
Can you get across?
Yeah.
Okay. It's the male. And the female's in the thicket. And where the female is, I don't know. In dry.
Cool. Thanks very much, Jamesy. So It's unusual to see Virem without a coffee cup in his hand. Normally, he is the king of coffee cups. He has multiple collections of stainless steel coffee cups that have Milo and coffee mixtures in them. And you can always tell where Virem's been in camp, because there is an empty coffee cup.
And wires.
And wires, and maybe a pair of pliers. So we just find a little spot to jump through here. Okay. Here we go. Okay. There we go. See where James has popped in, so we're just going to go very, very slowly into here. Now, Zander, have you ever seen a leopard in the wild?
No.
So, Zander's first leopard in the wild. Isn't this exciting? Just go very, very slowly. So, where we were with the kill is just over the other side of this termite mound, and I'm just going very slowly because I'm not sure where. Oh, there he is. Hello, my boy. It's just look at that. Look at him. He's protecting his scrub hair. Isn't that awesome? That is incredible. That's probably his first solo kill. Yum, yum, yum. So he's got a belly full of impala, but he still found it necessary to catch something for himself. What a clever young man. Or did his sister catch it and he stole it? I must wonder. So, I'm not exactly, James said, oh, there's Karula. Where Karula was, Karula is actually right next to us, hiding in the thicket, but we're going to stick with young Hosana, the little prince. So it turns out that my hunch was correct, that she was in one of these big blocks to the east of the Mwati River, where there's not a lot of roads. And fortunately, we were able to find her tracks and led us to where she killed that impala, which led us down here, which led us to them. And she has been proving quite tricky over the last few days. Okay, let's have a quick look. I want to see if we can see little Xongile somewhere. I can't, unfortunately. She could be anywhere around us. Have you seen Karula yet? Straight through this thicket. There's Karula. She's right in there. And you can see that camouflage at work. Yeah, I'm just going to move... Oops, sorry. I'm just going to move the car slightly. Sister came and tried to steal the scrub hair, and he's moved, so I'm just going to try and move a little bit so he can maybe see both of them. So he's trying to keep his little kill away from his sister. Okay, he's coming up towards him. So his sister was in the drainage line just below him, and he's watching her intently. That's my scrub hair, or my half a scrub hair. He might come join Karula. There we go. How's that, Chandra? Look at that! Isn't this amazing? Now, wouldn't it be even more... it's okay, madam. Wouldn't it be amazing if Xongile decided to try to steal it? Okay, we're just going to pull the handbrake up so we don't roll around. Now watch, he keeps looking over his back and checking for, there we go, see where he looks back? That's where I had a brief visual of his sister. Hopefully she comes out to join as well. Now Karula is looking a little bit grumpy this morning. She's hissing a little bit, and that could be she's a bit irritated by the presence of the male in the area. I'm not sure. So what I am going to do is, if she is feeling a little bit uncomfortable and snarling a bit, I'm going to move a bit further away from her. We obviously don't want to upset the queen. And you must remember, like people, animals also have bad days. They could be grumpy. So sorry, Xongile, I'm going to have to move. I'm just going to move away from her a little bit, give her a little bit more space, make her feel a bit more comfortable. So it's very important, because we do spend so much time with the Queen of Djuma, that if she is in a slightly bad mood, she might have had a bad night, she might have had an altercation with a male, if she is showing those little bit of signs of aggression, it's always better to just move away and give her a little bit more space. So we're just going to do that. Hopefully she's going to relax down a little bit from here. I know we don't have the best view of little Hosana from here, but she was snarling, and then immediately now we've moved a little bit further away, she's stopped and she seems a lot more relaxed. So, and every time you go into a sighting is different, so you can't read every sighting the same. And there we go, she's still, there we go, you see that? I think she must have had an altercation, or maybe the cubs are annoying her, or maybe there's just too many biting flies. Oh, actually now looking at her, I think it's the cubs, because she's snarling as she walks closer to us, so it's not us. But it's better to err on the side of caution with big cats. Okay, so Justin said, he's never seen Karula like this. Fascinating change in behavior from the queen. Now, she's smelling where that scrub hair was. So what I think, actually, it's, I think she's just a bit annoyed with the cubs. And as soon as he came closer to her, oh, she's licking the blood from the scrub hair, she started snarling. And I just wasn't sure whether it was because of us. Oh, she's got eating the stomach contents of the scrub hair. So I wasn't sure whether it was because of us. That's why I moved a little bit further away. But now we can see it's actually she's irritated with her own children and she's not snarling at us. But just in case she was, that's why I moved a little bit further away to just give her enough space, if it was us, to feel comfortable again. She's very close, Johnny, and she's being a bit snarly. So unfortunately, I'm going to stay where I am. So she's very, very close to us. She's no more than about 7 or 8 feet. And that's not uncommon with Karula. But if she is in a bad mood, just if she wants to come closer to us, that's fine. But we're not going to go closer to her. It's very interesting. So young Hosana decided he's quite fussy. He doesn't want to eat the stomach of the little scrub hair. But Queen Karula, even though she's got an impala across the way, has decided she will. Not all of it. Listen to that, she's chuffing. It's calling the cub, reprimanding the cub, and we can't be sure till we speak. I can't speak leopard. Chuff, chuff. Dina says she wonders if she's taking away the evidence of that scrub hair kill. I don't think so, Dina. I just think she's eating around the collar of the stomach, so she could be eating the heart, the lungs, and it's maybe some tasty choice titbits. Now, a little kill like a scrub hair. a little kill like a scrub hare is not going to leave any stuff that other predators are really going to pick up on. Safari Dean's being quite funny. He says, well, maybe Karula just doesn't like hipsters. Only joking. No, only joking. Sorry, I'll just be on the radio for a second. Oh, look at that. It's a little bit difficult. One vehicle for the moment. I'll move quite shortly, then I'll drop a branch on Leadwood for you. No problem at all. Just keep making your way. But there's only space for one vehicle to have a nice sighting. Look at that. Sorry about that. Some mysterious gremlin found us.
Sorry about that, everybody. Well, at least you got an incredible sighting. Two cubs and mother. And, a whole lot of lion cubs and a whole lot of lions today. A bumper morning, I'd say. We're heading on to quarantine clearings. Viam and I kind of assumed we were going to have an early breakfast, given that Brent was going to be with the leopards until the end of the drive. But we'll do a lap of quarantine and see what's there for the last few minutes. Oh, we might also show you Jamie Patterson, who's also off to an early breakfast. Morning, Jamie. There we go. She will not be happy with me when we get back to breakfast. Now, we have an intern with us at the moment whose name is Nicholas. And Nicholas has been tasked, apparently, to paint the trees on quarantine clearings with some kind of solution to stop the elephants pushing them over. It'll be very interesting to see if that actually works or not. That's of course because we don't want it to become quarantine desert. It's quite nice having quarantine parkland. All right, Brent is back online. We're going to say goodbye for the morning and we'll see you this afternoon. Thank you, Viam. Good job today, and thank you to all of you for joining us. We'll hand you back to Brent and see you later.
Oh, we're trying to get you a view of little Hosana, who's moved the kill towards us. I think I'm going to go backwards a little bit, and Karula's bad temperament is definitely caused by her children, because as soon as he came closer, she started snarling directly at him.
We're back again. Sorry about that. We were going to have our second early breakfast and now we're not anymore. Kirsten, I need to plan my route. How much time have we got?
4 minutes.
I was about to pull into the DRC. Lucky we didn't. Ooh. There's another woodpecker. In fact, there's a whole bird party going on here. Do not groan at me, Viam. There. Listen, it's calling. Now, if I'm not mistaken, I don't know which one that was. Hang on a second, let me play it. So there's some starlings there, there's some drongos, that's the starling you're looking at now. And I saw what looked like an orange-breasted bushrike also flowing past there. I just want to quickly play the woodpecker call. I think it may have been bearded. But as I say that, I think I might be wrong. Here's the bearded. Let's listen. Absolutely was not a bearded. Let's play the cardinal. It wasn't a cardinal either. That's interesting. Let's go. We only have two others. We have the Bennets and the golden-tailed. And the golden-tailed goes, Maybe it's got another call. That's it. Which means it could only have been a Bennett's. But I didn't think the Bennett's was found in trees like that. It was the Bennett's. That's really nice. That's very uncommon here. Ooh, and there's some hoopoes there. Alright, we're going to say goodbye again. I'm probably not going to go home just yet. Brent is back online and he's with Karula.
Okay, hopefully we don't move and we're able to stay with these incredible leopards. And there we go. Young Hosana is making very short work of that scrub hair. Yum, yum, yum. Rabbit for breakfast. Of course, it's not really a rabbit. It is a hare. I suppose we could call it a bunny. So Karula is continuing with her incredible hunting prowess. And I mean, she's at two adult impala in the last 3 days. It's incredible. And they're finishing them so quickly with these little cubs growing. Oh. Now the one thing is a little bit worrying is that this kill is on the ground, that impala kill. It hasn't been hoisted. And what has she noticed? She's noticed something. Don't think it's the arrow marked babblers calling on the other side. She might have just heard something, maybe another herd of impala moving in. So we're just going to extend for a few seconds and to make sure she hasn't seen anything, but it doesn't look like she has. So we will definitely be here on the Sun Has Set Safari to have some more time with Queen Karula and her cubs. And isn't this absolutely fascinating? It looks like Hosana has made his first kill at under 6 months. So from myself, Jandre, the rest of the Safari Live team, we'll see you in a couple of hours for a show full of lions and leopards.